Episode number 109. The monks had no longer an instant of repose. By day they did nothing but ascend and descend the steps which led to the chapel. At night, in addition to complaints and matins, they were further obliged to leap 20 times out of their beds and prostrate themselves on the floor of their cells. It is not known whether it was the devil who gave way, or the monks who grew tired. But within 3 months the penitent reappeared in the world with the reputation of being the most terrible possessed that ever existed. On leaving the convent he entered into the magistracy, became president on the place of his uncle, embraced the cardinal's party, which did not prove want of sagacity, became chancellor, served his eminence with zeal in his hatred against the queen mother and his vengeance against Anne of Austria, stimulated the judges in the affair of Calais, encouraged the attempt of M. de la Fameuse, chief gamekeeper of France, then, at length, invested with the entire confidence of the cardinal, a confidence which he had so well earned, he received the singular commission for the execution, of which he presented himself in the queen's apartments. The queen was still standing when he entered, but scarcely had she perceived him than she reseated herself in her armchair, and made a sign to women to resume their cushions and stools, and with an air of supreme hauteur, said, "What do you desire, monsieur, and with what object do you present yourself here?" "To make, madame, in the name of the king, and without prejudice to the respect which I have the honor to owe to your majesty a close examination into all your papers." "How, monsieur, an investigation of my papers, mine? Truly, this is an indignity." "Be kind enough to pardon me, madame, but in this circumstance I am but the instrument which the king employs. Has not his majesty just left you, and has he not himself asked you to prepare for this visit?" "Such, then, monsieur. I am a criminal, as it appears. Estafania, give up the keys of my drawers and my desks." For form's sake the chancellor paid a visit to the pieces of furniture named, but he well knew that it was not in a piece of furniture that the queen would place the important letter she had written that day. When the chancellor had opened and shut 20 times the drawers of the secretaries, it became necessary, whatever hesitation he might experience, it became necessary, I say, to come to the conclusion of the affair, that is to say, to search the queen herself. The chancellor advanced, therefore, toward Anne of Austria, and said with a very perplexed and embarrassed air, "And now it remains for me to make the principal examination." "What is that?" asked the queen, who did not understand, or rather was not willing to understand. "His majesty is certain that a letter has been written by you during the day. He knows that it has not yet been sent to its address. This letter is not in your table, nor in your secretary, and yet this letter must be somewhere. Would you dare to lift your hand to your queen?" said Anne of Austria, drawing herself up to full height, and fixing her eyes upon the chancellor with an expression almost threatening.